thanks everybody. Today I'm going to share some fuzz technology about in-depth analysis and fuzzing for Qualcomm Hexagon processor. And I'm Gong Xiling. Now I'm working for Google, but all this work was finished when I'm a member of the Tencent Blade team. So all this presentation belongs to Tencent Blade team. Okay, so let's go through the agenda. First, we will introduce some background about what is Hexagon and why we are following Hexagon. And then we will talk about the Hexagon father, the portable solutions, and the pros and the cons of every portable solution. And then we will talk about our solution and why we choose this solution. Then we will introduce the overall architecture and the key components. And also we will cover the troubleshooting and the fruits. There may be some difference between the brief published on the Black Hat Asia website, but I think with a better focus on the key point. So I made some simple change about the content to release. Okay. So why we are following Hexagon? So first, we know Qualcomm is the leading smartphone processor. It's the biggest smartphone processor in the world. So Qualcomm's product is very attractive. So on Qualcomm's stock, there are several subsystems. Maybe you know the modem, the Wi-Fi, the video, the audio, and the Bluetooth NFC. So generally, we can see there is an application processor, and then we have several subsystems. So you can see from the graph that the subsystems in yellow color or Hexagon processor, you know, the modem and the Wi-Fi, MPU for AI, and ADSP for audio, for application DSP, and the vision about the camera. All these subsystems are Hexagon processor. So Hexagon processor is very important in Qualcomm's SoC. That's why we are interested about Qualcomm Hexagon, and we are going to follow it. Okay, why? So why that is? Hexagon is widely used in Qualcomm platform, especially baseband and ADSP are pretty high value targets for the attacks and for the researchers. Okay, so why we are following Hexagon? There are several reasons. The first one is that it's a closed source. So, as I know, all the Hexagon closed source target. You don't have any source code, so it's pretty high cost if you are going to reverse engineer in the Hexagon target. So when you do the reverse engineering, the Hexagon has no decompiler yet. That is your IDA. You can only use the disassembler. It has no decompiler yet. Also, this low effective Hexagon father. What is effective? I think coverage guided father is effective. If you are using the black box father, of course it's not effective. So I don't know, there's no effective Hexagon father yet. So also you can see some of the subsystem such as baseband subsystem, it is really complicated. So if you are going to reverse engineering this subsystem, it is very complex. So fuzzing is obviously a good choice. And for other targets, for example, the ADSP, you know, audio DSP, application DSP, there are lots of decode and encode functions. So, in fact, it's very suitable for fuzzing. So, when you are targeting this target, it's better to fuzz instead of just manually reverse engineering. And finally, I have to say it's feasible. I will show you in this presentation. So, as you can see, there is low effective hexagon fuzzer and the high value target. So I think it's a bigger potential in fuzzing the hexagon. So we are going to fuzz it. Before we go, I think we'd better introduce some basic knowledge about hexagon. Actually, there are plenty of document presentation in recent years, so you can go through if you are interested about the basic information of hexagon. That are really useful, I think. So I will only highlight something I think is very important for you to understand hexagon now in this presentation. If you are interested, you can go through the other document and learn from them. Okay. So the Hexagon DSP processor has a 32-bit address space. It's little ending. The program code and the code are stored unified, stored together. And there are registers, 32-bit general purpose register can be considered as a single register or as a 64-bit register pair. That means you can access two registers at the same time. And the most important thing is the parallel execution. Instructions can be grouped into a very long instruction world. We will see this later. And the cached memory, and this is also very important that they have a virtual memory. There is a virtual to physical memory mapping. Virtual memory supports the memory management and the protection. Okay, let's go to the very long instruction world. The hexagon supports four instructions at the same time. There are two data instructions and two execution instructions. That means you can access to two memory space at the same time and run two general instructions. That is total overall four instructions overall. Okay. Also, there are three hardware threads. So you can see that this architecture looks like a multi-core with communication through shared memory. The three threads at the same time running. Okay. So let's have a glance at the hexagon instruction. It is a little bit different with ARM or x86. You can see there is an instruction pair, which means they can execute at the same time at one instruction slot. Yeah, there is some special instruction such as loop. It's a hardware loop. You just specify the start address of the instruction and the count, then it will loop through. In this count, you can see from here to here, there is an end loop. So this loop will go through D line C4 to to here to the end loop for 10 times. Okay, then there are very long instructions. You can see this instruction is pretty long. Okay, so others are similar to C code and very convenient to read. Okay. Okay. So let's go to the next section. That is the hexagon fuzz. We will talk about the possible solutions and the trade-off, and also introduce our solution and explain why we choose this solution. Also, we will talk about the overall architecture of our fuzz and the key components, and finally, we will cover the troubleshooting and the flaws. Okay. So, the possible solution of fuzz, as we just talked about, that hexagon is closed source. So this is actually a problem of closed source target with older processor. Why we so it is older? Because there is no decompiler, no security tools that help us to do the general investigation. So this is an older processor. So how to solve this problem? In general, there are two methods, that is dynamic injection and virtualization. Also, you may think you can use symbolized execution or more tricky, you can use AI or black box fuzz. But I don't think it's a good method at all. So we are focusing on dynamic injection and virtualization. Okay, so this graph shows the most important thing of an effective fuzz is the code coverage. So for this issue, this problem, the closed source target with all the processor. So how to get a code coverage? That's actually the problem we are going to solve. And once you get the code coverage, you have a lot of method, a lot of way to improve the fuzz. So let's check it. You know the dynamic injection that you inject the code into the running real target. Then in the target running. You inject some code into it. It's a real target, so you inject the code into a real target and collect the feedback from the target. Then you get the code coverage, so you can solve this problem. And another way is the virtualization. You maybe emulate the target. For example, using QEMU or other virtualization technique, then you can virtualize the target, run the target in a fake environment. Then you can get the feedback and get the code coverage. So you can solve this problem. So I think we'd better compare the difference between dynamic injection and virtualization. Obviously, when you want to inject some code into a real target, the cost is very high because you have to do a lot of trick. You have to override the instructions, and do some very difficult code in the target. So I don't think it's very easy, it's very high cost, and because you are doing some tricky, you are doing some hack action, So it's not very stable. The target may be disrupted by your code. So it's not very stable. Also, it's not flexible. That means when you follow this target and you want to switch it for another target, you still have to do a lot of job. That's not very commonplace solution. So you have to do a lot of extra job when you want to switch the target. So it's no flexibility, I think. Also, there are no performance. The performance is limited by the target you are following. If you are using a form, the performance of the form is the limitation. So I think it's no performance. You have no way to increase the performance. Also, there is no scalability. Think about you are going to following 100 target. You have to buy 100 form. The form is very expensive. Well, even if you buy a cheap form, 100, 1,000, 10,000, that's very cost. So the scalability is very low if you use this method. And finally, the target should be debuggable. You have to able to attach to the target. You have to able to inject some code into the target. So the target should be debuggable. Of course, the some advantages. You see the pros that if you are using dynamic injection, you can inject the code into the target that is running. So it's real running status, also running on real hardware. So you have a chance to get a very good code coverage, a real code coverage that you can improve in a very good basis. So I think this is a very well approach that you can expect from the dynamic injection. Okay, so another way is virtualization. If there is no emulator yet available for you to virtualize the target, the cost will be very high. However, if you already have an emulator, it will be a low cost. So it depends on how the status yet. Then the hardware dependence problem. A lot of targets, especially the hexagon target, depends on the hardware. For example, for the modem, you have to run the modem firmware on the real device. Otherwise, a lot of function will not go well. Also, there is another problem is that the fake running status, you may be unable to get a real running status and in the real target. So the problem is also difficult to solve, but virtualization has a lot of advantages. First one is stability. If you got a stable virtualization, then the solution is very stable. So another is flexibility and performance and scalability, which is, you know, you can virtualize it everywhere in the cloud, server or on your own PC. It's very easy to expand or scale the target. So what do we choose? Actually, we choose the dynamic injection, which looks not very good, but actually we choose this method. We are going to explain why. 外面去 dynamic injection。The main problem is that there is no Hexagon emulator when we start the work. You know, the first Hexagon emulator is in the 2019 by Turner and Qualcomm. We start our work at the end of 2018. So when we start our work, there is no such an emulator for Hexagon. So we actually have no choice. We can only choose to run our father on the real device. Also, I think another problem is the baseband is difficult to emulate. We are aimed to find the baseband. Even if you have an emulator for Hexagon, it's difficult to emulate the baseband. Baseband heavily rely on hardware and running environment, such as secure boot and trustzone. Maybe some researchers have found the baseband of Samsung or MediaTek on an emulator, but I think a quick baseband is difficult to emulate. Even if it's feasible, it's hard to improve the coverage. Yeah. So I don't think we are going to choose virtualization. Even today there is a Hexagon emulator. So the very important the reason is that the first challenge of dynamic injection is injection. You have to inject some code into the target. To lots of researchers, it's impossible to inject code into the running baseband. But for us, we have a very good debugger that allows us to inject code into the Hexagon processor. So for us, it is feasible to choose the dynamic injection. So that's the reason why we are choosing this solution. Okay. So here we are going to explain what is dynamic injection. First, you have to realize that we are inject code into a real running target. So we are inject code into the running baseband. You can see the following code running on the modern subsystem that is running on the baseband. We inject some hacker code. You can see the jump code into the modem and overwrite the original code and let the code jump to our feedback engine and do some job. After the job is done, we jump back. So we inject the code and do some job and jump back. That is the dynamic injection. Okay. So this is a simple flow of what the job we have done. When we jump from the original code, we will protect the environment, such as registers and memory. So we will protect the environment and do our job. Here, the main job we finish is that we collect the feedback information and send it back to the lab father. We will know that later. So after we finish our job, we restore the environment and then execute the original instructions that have been override by our jumper, by this code. We will execute the original instruction so that the program feel it doesn't have been injected. Okay, then we back to the normal code flow. We are back here. So it's a simple flow of dynamic injection. Okay, so how about we inject the code to every block of the code? We inject the code here and collect the feedback information and inject the code here and here. If we inject the code to every block, then we can collect the running status of the program, so we can collect a lot of useful information. So most importantly, we can use this information to calculate the code coverage. Okay, so that's what we have done. Okay, so let's discuss about the overall architecture of the fuzz. So as we know, we have an Android form, and there is a debugger run on the Android system, and also a lab fuzz running on the system, and they are used to debug and fuzz the hexagon. The hexagon is also in the form. It's on another subsystem. So we use the debugger to debug the hexagon and use the lab fuzz to fuzz the hexagon. Then when the hexagon receives the command, it will feedback, or it will do what the debugger expected it to do. So this is the main component. And also we have a computer. A computer used to generate patch for the debugger, and also used to analyze the information from the hexagon and from Android. I will demo how to use the analyzer. Okay. On the Android, its main job is the lab fuzz, which is a run test case and improve test case. You know, lab fuzz generally will collect code coverage in process, but here we have modified the lab fuzz so that it will feed the test sample into the hexagon, and then after the hexagon has consumed the test sample, it will feed back some information to the lab fuzz so that lab fuzz could improve the test case. So that's a positive loop. So we can see that the coverage, code coverage, is increasing. Okay. So when the fuzz is running, we are collect some information from the fuzz. We are using this information to analyze the running status of the target, and also if necessary, we are generate a new patch to increase the code coverage. Okay, so the three main components is the computer, the Android, and the hexagon processor. Okay, this is the overall architecture in detailed information. You can see the main component is on the Android system, there is a debugger client to debug the target, and also there is a lab fuzz client to fuzz the target. On the target, there is a sample consumer and the feedback engine to help lab fuzz to improve the test case. And on the PC, there are lots of analyzer tools help the lab fuzz to get better understanding of the target and also the patch generator and the dynamic information collector help us to understand the current status of the fuzz. So that's all about the fuzz. Yeah, I think we have finished the architecture and the explanation of the fuzz, how we fuzz the hexagon model. Of course, there are a lot of troubles. The big problem, I think, when I developed the system is that the stability of the debug and the feedback engine. There are a lot of bugs. For example, the attack depth, maybe you have damaged the stack because the stack depth is too deep, and maybe you have collapsed some general register, or maybe the original instruction executed incorrectly. So you have to spend a lot of time to fix these bugs and to distinguish it from a crash caused by the test sample or a crash caused by your engine. The good news is that you can eventually find and solve all these bugs. So I spent a lot of time solving the bugs. And now it's running pretty stable. So it's a good news. About other problems, such as the cost, the scalability, and the performance, if you are going to fuzz the target with many fuzzers, it's better to solve these problems. The best solution is using a development board instead of the form. If you use real form it's very expensive. Yeah, but for the development board, it's quite cheap. So you can buy lots of development board and deploy lots of fuzzers simultaneously. So you can run a lot of fuzzers at the same time. So you can solve the cost and the performance problem, I think. Just be aware of reduce the overhead of the fuzz. Okay. Then about the fruit, the outcome. So currently we have found at least 5 vulnerabilities which have been confirmed by Qualcomm, and also our fuzz is still running. There are still lots of components have not been fuzzed, so I think there are still many vulnerabilities could be defined using this fuzz. Also, we have found lots of crashes and lots of efforts. In general, there are a lot of vulnerabilities. However, I think they are very useful information, because if you use a lot of crashes or efforts, it means that the code quality here is not very good. So there are a lot of chance for the security researchers. Okay. So let's see how the fuzz works. Okay. Here we are running on the PC to generate patch for the fuzz. Then you can see there are totally 180 blocks forked, lots of code injected into the model. Then we will actually generate the patch. Mm-hmm. Okay, we have generated all the patches we need. So we are going to run the fuzz. Okay, the debugger is running, and we are going to inject the code into the modem. Now the code injected into the modem, and all the patches are done. So the fuzz is actually running. Okay. It's still not running. Let's see. Let's watch another video. Yeah. Let's review the status of the fuzz. You can see that the 99 test sample has been fed by the fuzz. Now it's 510 samples have been tested. Yeah. So the fuzz is running. Here is another demo. Once we get information from the fuzz, we can see what happened inside of the target. So we have show some output from where we collect from the feedback engine and from the code coverage. Okay. Well, I think we have done. So there are some related works you can refer to if you are interested. The next work is by Alisa Asage about the Hexagon diagram and getting started with baseband vulnerability research. That's very useful. Research. So thank you. Bye bye.